All right, let's go. Welcome to The Search, Spanian's first podcast. Highly anticipated, long-awaited podcast. It's Cut for Urch. I got my first guest here. It's one of the brothers I grew up with. His name's Ray. Very interesting story. Love my brother. Glad to have him as my first guest. Storm, brother.
Hey, brother. I'm glad to be your first guest. And yeah, it's Raymond. Everyone knows me, but they call me Rage. I got the name. I don't know how I got it. I think Jazza gave it to me. Jazza. Lady of Rage. Yeah. Rage Against the Machine. Lady of Rage.
So, bro, where'd you grow up, lad? Like, as a child, bro, you know, like, I met you when you were 12.
Yeah.
What was your life like around those times? Because these lads, they don't understand, bro. See, these lads, like, they don't understand how life was back then. In the streets, up the block, Waterloo, on the gear?
Yeah.
On the gear, a 12-year-old, heroin addict, that's breaking in, stealing stuff out of the back of cars, 12 years old. So, like, bro, how long were you doing that for, like, How did that life come about, brother? Tell me, give me the background of your life, brother. Because I know your life, not all of it, but from all the times we spent in cells and hurt, I know your life, brother, and your life is a very extreme, bar. You're the furthest from a Johnny come lately. What I mean by Johnny come lately is those people with good upbringings that decide to be criminals when they're 17. They get the bad boy streak and all of a sudden they're bad. You're the opposite of that. I know your life was this from day dot. Like, give a like a rough explanation how this come about, bro. And this story here, this is not unique to him. This is not unique to me. I've got a very similar story. I say his is more of an extreme story than mine. But there's boys with worse. Some of our brothers got worse stories even. But like, give us a rundown, brother. Like, how'd you end up down the block, Redfern? What, you know?
Oh, my family generated from the block. They're a Rigidage from Sydney.
Mm-hmm.
As a younger lad, me and my mum, my dad and my mum being around in the 80s, heroin was a big thing. So they had the Cabramatta Express and Redfern was just teaming with heroin.
And where did you live then?
I lived...
Redfern, Urco, somewhere like that?
Yeah, I was jumping from foster parents to my aunties and uncles.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I spent a majority of my life down Erskineville with... first of all, it started at Botany Road, Redfern. With my pop and his 8 kids, and or he used to take heaps of people in, Sessmans at Botany Road.
So was he the elder in your family that used to look after the kids?
Yeah, he was the elder,
and
then he's my aunties and my uncles, and they used to, half of them was on the gear, half of them wasn't. And then my pop migrated from there down to Erskineville.
Migrated.
That's a full migration.
To
Urco. And then where he...
And what, in a house, eh? You got a house in Urco?
Of course, house. Always house.
Because that's what I first remember you living down in Urco, house.
Yeah.
That was at your pops. I thought it was your uncles.
My pops my uncles.
And your uncle there,
And my uncle Rajo, who I'm named after. And all the boys know, they used to always come down there because... had to connect and it was like the place, you know.
I remember that.
Then my dad died.
How old were you then?
I was younger than the 12. My dad passed away when I was about 10. It took me 2 years to... I was still going to school, but I was still going to school.
Your dad?
Yeah, I knew him. He used to pop around and give me money and shit. He was an old school cream. The way he passed away, he done something. He got shot.
He got shot.
Yeah.
Doing something.
Doing a armed rob. Shot by a guard. And one of the bullets passed through him. The other one lodged. He got it. Went to a surgery. One of his surgeons and probably some dingy Asian and just got a bullet removed and the other one went straight through and fessed up. Then by that time he would have had warrants or whatever. Don't go
for
to
the
hospital.
Robbery,
eh?
So then the bullet got infected.
Yeah.
And he's got bait in his head. He's got warrants out.
Yeah.
So he's thinking like, fuck it, I'd rather just cop it because if I go get fixed, they're going to grab me.
They're going to grab me.
That's common. That sounds crazy like that you could be saying your dad is like bang, shot, doing an arm rob, gets shot, has an infection and doesn't want to go to the hospital because like he thinks like he's going to get upgraded. You know what I mean? But that's common, bro. That's the thing. But anyway, go on.
And it fessed up, gangrene. From that, he got pneumonia and passed away. Then when he passed away, because he was the youngest.
This happened down where? Down Redfern?
Yeah, this happened around. Yeah. And my dad was the youngest, and my pop, like, you know, and your youngest kid dying before you, and pop wasn't the same then.
Yeah.
And then pop passed away tragically a year later after that. So I lose my dad, then I lose my pop, and they were like the big male role figures in my life. And then after that, I had no authority, no people. Like, my uncle was there, but he was doing his own shit.
He didn't give a fuck.
He was doing his own shit. He still couldn't comprehend losing dad, and everyone puts the blame. Grief is a strong emotion. Grief is a strong emotion, and I didn't know how to cope with it, so I started running the streets, looking for, I don't know, some comfort, looking for whatever I was looking for. That's when.
So this around how old? 11, 12 years old?
Yeah, 11, 12. That's when I started running and never lived with my mum. My mum, I only have my dad. My mum's still alive to this day, but she's lost without dad because she didn't know her family. She only knew dad's family, and they blamed her for dad's loss. Saying that. Everyone looks for someone else to blame. You know, even to this day, I used to blame my mum for my upbringing. You know, I used to blame my mum and blame anyone.
I remember down the block when I was young, I always say your mum.
Yeah. Well, all the boys used to look after everyone's family.
Yeah.
Didn't matter. And that was our motto, share the wealth, you know, in between our little crew.
Yeah.
Didn't matter. If you, even back in the day, you remember, if you used to split up.
Yeah.
And just say you get a chase or whatever, and then bang, I get a earn.
Come back, split.
Yeah, you're still entitled to a split.
Yeah,
because we both went, we all went 100. Out together.
If you cut together.
That's right. We're both putting the same risk.
Yeah.
We're both 100%. Same risk. So if we split up, but then you get gamer cunts like Paul Dean and that just used to run away and wait at the block wanting a split.
Yeah. Cut for a surge.
Yeah.
But it can't legit. We'll cut for a search if you are, and then step straight away, and then go back to the block and wait, and then you come back with an urn, and they think, bro, we cut together.
Yeah, and then when you don't want to give them shit, because they don't deserve shit, because they're little scared mouse, and they, I'll get my brother, I'll get this, and I'll get that, and you know what I mean? They still,
but so what's the first, like, things that you got into, lad? Like, the first, so when you, boom, hit the streets, how did this, so how did you get on the e-gay, lad? Like, how did that come about?
I remember it clear as day.
Yeah.
The boys are like, let's go back to Lucy Street, back to Brandy's.
And
so back then, Capsule 25.
Lucy Ashfield.
Yeah,
Ashfield. When he lived Ashfield,
Back then, Capsule 25.
Yeah.
And it was my first time ever. I used to smoke your auntie.
Because boys were, they were Azalan already, eh?
Yeah, Brandy they were.
Azalan is like smoking heroin. Some people call it spotting. Some people, we used to call it Azalan. Putting heroin on foil smoking it, pretty much. Chasing, so they were Azalan already,
And so they were already Azalan. I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
And so I got my money and we cut back to Brandy's and I buy two caps, just bridging up, wanting to be one of the boys, the older boys. And
but who told you to spot? Like, which one of the Aussies actually said, put it here? The one of the boys light it? Or did they tell you, watch them and?
I think one of the boys played a joke. They packed a snowy and then put pot on top.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't know who it was. They put a snow cone and then put pot on top.
So
I wouldn't know what it was.
Then
when I had it.
Laters. It would shape
I just like felt like I didn't feel the pain of my dad, of what I was doing. Like I just felt. Bliss. It was heavenly bliss. The first time that I ever had it was heavenly bliss.
Yeah.
And when you're under that thing, I just, it was just so.
But I feel the same, like, even though I haven't used heroin now for what? 2007, 14 years. I still say, out of all the drugs I've used, anything, it's by far, the best feeling. Yeah. By far. But then, and I understand how it's so dangerous. Because the feeling is just so like, perfect. You know what I mean? Not when you jump off it, but when you're on it. Not when you jump off it.
And that's funny. I got a funny yarn about when I first didn't have heroin, and I
was that the first time you went boys' homes?
No, it was at when I was at Johnny's. I was at Johnny Jordan's. I'm over Mikkel.
Yeah. At Waterloo.
We're scoring
Mikkel's off. Mikkel's one of the projects at Waterloo.
We're scoring off these dirty Asians. And the gear was hectic. Like, you know, Tommy, Jimmy, this gear was hectic. And these two dirty Asians that was selling at Walker Street.
Yeah.
Not Tommy and Jimmy. I'm not talking about them being dirty Asians. I'm talking these other dirty Asians that used to live down Leb Lane.
They
had their big fingernails chopping up blocks of gear. Like, just boom. And Uri Khan, Dazza Haynes, nigga Daz.
Yeah.
Johnny used to get on for me because I was little and I couldn't get it.
Yeah.
So they're asleep waiting for things. So I let them sleep for hours. All this time, I'm like getting, like my guard's like, and I'm like, oh, and it's the first time hanging and I thought I was hungry. So I went and got a feed, chips and gravy roll.
Yeah, yeah.
And then all of a sudden, when I ate it, I felt even more sicker.
Yeah.
Then I'm like, and Uric used to live in Mikkel, but he converted a laundry into his own room. So he's got a bed
and
fucking thing in a storeroom.
Yeah.
And so I'm fucking like, and then all of a sudden, I full follow through. I didn't have no clothes, and Johnny used to live straight across the road from Walker Street. I reefed off my aunt's pay, ran across the road, like with just my shirt, naked, ran across the road, buzzed the fucking buzzer. His sister answered the door. And I'm half butt naked and I'm like, oh, and so I ran into Johnny's room, grabbed his fucking, had a shower, grabbed his clothes and—
poo on your cheeks.
Yeah, poo on my cheeks. And didn't know what—
left the scent in the hallway.
Yep, left them. Yep,
left the scent in the bedroom. Down the garbage chute,
because it was 12 fucking floors. Put that fucking, wrap that shit, throw it down the fucking— The thing, yeah, it was the first time that I fucking knew that I was like hanging. I didn't know the consequences that come, because you have money and you don't think that there's consequences. You think that it can all go and you just want to keep chasing that feeling.
Yeah, 100%.
That feeling. And when you have old kids money.
How many of the brothers, us boys, YWB boys, and other boys too, even the boys down Eblay, how many or what percentage of our generation, realistically, live like that and we got on the heroin? What percent? Nearly all of us,
Nearly all of us.
But I could name on like, out of 100, 150 of us, how many could you name that weren't heroin addicts when we were kids?
Not many.
Maybe two?
Not many. I really can't name.
Maybe Roscoe?
Yeah, Roscoe. All right.
Adbray RK?
Yeah, Brad Carr. Yeah.
Roscoe, how many more of us? But like, that's what I mean. It's hard to think even more. That's two out of 150 of us. And out of all the boys that did, so nearly all of us, how many of us defeated it? How many of us changed until this day? Because we're talking 21 years ago.
None.
And that's realistic, bro. This is what a lot of people don't understand. Like, we're talking and how many of us, brothers, be realistic here, from 21 years ago when we jumped on the ear gay to now, all right, how many of us spend our lives in jail?
All of us. I'm the only one out.
You're out?
Yeah.
Well, there may be one or two more. Yeah. Who's even out?
I don't know.
And I'm talking all of us, legit. I'm talking to these people out here because they don't understand. They hear someone do a few years, this and that. I'm talking 150 of us kids. Willow Waterloo Refn. I'm talking 148 of us on heroin as little kids. And all of us doing how many years you done? But I've done I say 12 and a half, 13 years altogether, boys homes, this and that. How long you done altogether?
As soon as I turned 18, I went in.
But boys homes, include boys homes.
Oh, boys homes.
Just a rough, you don't got a city calculator, but just a rough.
Well, 10 I'm plus, 30, right? Easy. 10 easy, plus. Nearly more than half my life.
But close to 15 years, eh?
Easy.
Yeah.
Easy, all up. It's fucking sad. This is my longest run that I've had. Yeah.
When was the first time we were in ALJ together?
The first time is when you got bail. That was the first time.
Oh, that was the first time?
Yeah, that was the first time in jail. And then
how much jail did you end up doing, bro? When you talk about your jail.
But if you're talking about the longest lagging we've done together, was at Bathurst. 2008. We were two out. I was on the chicken soup. Used to keep the seagulls away from me. Used to get the fucking in locking when they, Ray, anything, anything. boom, full Glen 20 matches. Spraying
so
their
what
eyeballs.
He means by this, listen, let me explain this. Let me explain this. By saying that he's on the chicken, what he's saying that he, you were on the bupe.
Yep.
All right. And back by seagulls, he means the junkies. Yep. All right. So he's on the bupe. You know the bupe by now. He comes back. He's got all the goods. All the junkies, the seagulls, will come flocking at the door while he's getting his bupe out, this and that, this and that. But I used to, legit, but it's funny that you remember that. So I used to keep the seagulls away.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
While he's thinking, I used to look out like, you know, they used to come up because the doors in Bathurst, right? It's like big steel doors, but there's a little hole, all right? So they'll come up like this, bro. Like they're hanging their guts out, trying their best. They'll come up like this. Adlai, what are you doing? It's me. And I put their little hole, eye there. Bro, it's a what, lad? You know what I mean, bro? I got stuff here, bro. I haven't got an acupay, pay, but I got a couple cans of tuna. And I'll be like, bro, and like annoying. They're annoying, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So what I end up doing, we had Glen 20.
Yep. Always.
With matches, because there was smoking back then. I used to get the Glen 20 legit. Cunts would come up. Unky J's would come up to the window. What do you want, day lad? Next minute. I used to, I swear to God, shoot a big flamethrower out the door. I used to burn their eyeballs. I used to burn their lips. Mate, seagull would come up. What are you doing, lad? And he would go next minute. The whole face. Flamethrower on the whole face, but that was crack up shit, lad. Even if I got a sniff of him, even if I heard, outside, just send out a warning shot.
And it was mad too, because even on the weekends, like when the cells were fucking open, you know what I mean? They'll all be, and you'll be telling these cunts like 20 million times, because I had a roster who gets freebies and all this. They wanted a freebie every day.
Yeah.
And there's only so much you can help. And then they get jealous and they fucking want to
It's nothing but dramas. You know, I remember when I was on a chicken in there, I used to, half your dose you get out, you want to give it to people.
Yeah.
You give it to the people you respect. You don't want, you know what I mean? And you keep people happy. Like whatever crew you eat, like you with the brothers, you give it to the brothers. So I was always with the brothers in jail. When I was on, you give it to the brothers. You know what I mean? And then half of it, so you're about looking after yourself. So you want to make money, make sure you got food, this and that. But it's just constant headaches. And
especially
no one's ever happy enough.
Yeah.
No one's ever happy. You can never, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Long so how long did you do in that yarn, Lagan? What were you in for then?
I was in for the same, for aggravated brakes, caddies.
But is that the long Lagan that you done? The last Lagan you done, all right, what were you in for?
Aggravated brake and then it's time free.
Free aggravator brakes. And it was, what happened? Tell me what happened.
So apartment blocks, I jump up three stories, do my Spider-Man thing, caddies, but.
So you climbed the apartment block and you've done a few balconies.
Yeah, I've been charged with this, so.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. You still, so you've done a few balconies?
Yep, done a few balconies, gone in there, but not just one balcony, the next door.
Yeah.
So consecutives?
Yeah, different houses.
Yeah, so I've done three in the same flat.
Different premises. Yeah, in the same apartment block.
Apartment block.
Yeah. And what happened in that Lagan, bruh?
And what happened in that Lagan? Yeah. So,
because what I know, you want me to tell what I know?
Yeah.
All right, so I haven't seen you since 08. I didn't see you in jail since 08.
Yeah.
What I heard was that you were at some point in your lag, you were at Windsor.
Yeah.
None of the other boys were there.
No.
All right, you were at Windsor with a whole bunch of what? Aussies, Asians, and stuff like that. None of the other brothers were there. You got into some dispute. I don't know. This is just a thing I heard. I heard you got into some dispute. Either you were supposed to get bupe and you didn't, or you owed a debt for bupe and you didn't, and everyone turned on you, and you end up in protection. You end up going to the Boneyard.
Yeah.
Is that similar to what happened? You don't want to hear it from like your side.
Well, what happened was I was with Changa.
Yeah, you're with Changa,
I was with Changa. I'm in Sydney in A wing, Chang is in B wing, and I end up getting a hold of Shannon Simpson.
Yeah,
Shannon sending me in bupe.
Yeah,
but because I just got, and I'm in boxes, and I can't get the visit.
Box visits. He's on box visits. That means non-contact visits. So you're in a visit, like, so you're in behind glass with each other.
Yep.
So you got bupe sent, but you end up getting box visits, so you couldn't
get... Yeah, I couldn't get it in. So, I had this lad in the same wing, Clarkie, a white lad, that was...
I think
his
I know Clarkie.
His girl was meeting up with Shannon on the outside, getting the chicken, the chicken soup, bringing it in through the visits.
Yep.
And so he was only sending in seven strips, so he gets four... And I get free.
Yep.
And then at the time. So that's happening. Then
the names aren't important.
Okay, yeah. Old mate ends up going to Oberon.
Yep, yep.
From Windsor. So I've got
So Clarky, we know his name already. Yep. He goes to Oberon, but he's the one supposed to be bringing the Ubers in.
All right. So I've got no thing.
So you can't get it in,
I ask Changa.
Yep.
Then Changa does it, and then I end up getting thing, but he don't go harsh with me. Changa. He takes 5 and gives me 2.
Yep, yep.
Even though Shannon's sending it in for me and both of them. But now he's saying that he has to buy it and all
so
this
it's getting
shit.
Sent for you. But because he's getting it in, he's saying you get 2.
Yeah, and now he's saying
there's nothing you can do about it. It's different wings.
That's right, different wings, this and that. Yep. And then, so my Jack Rabbit has gone in and I've just come off the street. And
your habit,
I've just done 08 to 010. I've only lasted not even 3 weeks. So my head's all over the place. I get done for that. And so my head's all over the place and I'm waiting on, I know charges are coming back. Yep. I just don't know which ones.
Yeah.
By then I am chopping in.
Yeah.
And that left me with a raging habit. Yeah, so now I'm left trying to chase strips and bute. So I end up going through one another lad, through one of the lebs, one of the Trump lebs, and saying, don't worry lad, just tick me up 2 Ipstrays and I'll give you free back and money and all this. Yeah. I end up getting into debt that I couldn't handle.
Yeah.
Just being a dickhead, doing this and that. At the end of the day, I thought, oh, fuck it, I'll just fire it or whatever.
I know the lad you're talking about.
Yeah, he's got some boys underneath him that want to add. Well, you know, the head honcho gives the directions to the young bull runners.
Yeah.
The head honcho hasn't gave no directions to the young bull runners.
Mm-hmm.
The bull runners just thought, we'll run the ball up. We know this bloke's in air day. We'll run the ball up.
So you're talking about other young Lebo lads?
Yep.
You're there, who's there? Who's on your team? No one?
No cup.
What brothers were you there with? Any brothers at all?
None from our area, just country brothers. Like
country brothers?
No country, and you know, in jail, country versus city, and all this shit, and just all politics.
So what he's saying is like-
schoolyard antics.
What he's saying is there, say like, he's with the brothers, the Couries, but sometimes there's even a division between the Couries from the city and the Couries from the country. Sometimes the Couries from the country, they're a bit spiteful because the Couries from the city, like Ray from where we're from, we're a bit more, I'm Couri, but the brothers from the city are a bit different. They're more like about making money and get along with the other races better, I noticed, from my opinion. Yeah. And the Couries from the country, full-blown racist.
Yeah.
Like, why are you talking to them cunts? Why are you talking to them? Yeah, you know what I mean?
Different. You can't talk to anyone.
The Couries from the city and Couries from the country, not saying they're completely different, but in jail, they're like 2 different races semi. Do you know what I mean? Not to say like a lot of the brothers don't get along. I'm just saying like in your example there, so you're stuck.
I'm a brother saying that.
You're stuck in a wing, just only brothers from the country. Yeah. So they'd have been from Burke, Willow, this and that.
Cunts that I don't know and don't get
along with.
Don't get along with well because any other brother from this, I shout like, but there's only so much I can shout. And then they get a little bit early day and whatever.
Yeah. And but anyway, look,
they see me getting these Ipstrays and I haven't been sharing. So they're a bit.
So that's why, because you didn't give them nothing.
Yeah, because I haven't been giving them nothing. Well, I've got my own mouth to feed. I can't feed other mouths.
Yeah. 100%. Okay?
And that's why, shit. Well, the young ball runners have ran the ball up.
Yeah.
And fucking try to come in and cause a commotion and this and that. And then I end up getting.
Tell me exactly. Like, I want to hear because I don't even know this. So they come into your cell?
Yeah, they come into my cell.
A few of them?
Yeah, a few of them, boy. And you're fucking this and that. And
you owe,
like, and fucking threatening pay to, this. Threatening to stab me.
To stab you. Yep.
This and that. And fact, well, get into a commotion with, like, I don't give a fuck.
Don't say names. Do I know any of them? Or just nobody's?
No.
Just young lads.
Yeah, just young lads
trying to impress.
Yeah.
All right, yeah.
Well, they're probably somebody now in jail, probably maybe wasting now. Away.
Yeah. Probably somebody now wasting away.
Yeah, they're probably somebody now wasting away. But,
but.
Well,
and so they then. Come in, gave you that yarn.
Yeah, and then 3 of them come in, so we get into a little scruffle, fighting and this and that. There was a shift produced.
Yeah.
Fucking this and that. And then right where I'm in 2SL, I'm with Steve Stanley. I'm 2-0 with Steve Stanley.
Little Aussie Steve?
Steve Stanley, he's around fucking He's at work at the moment.
Yeah.
So
tiny little lad couldn't do anything.
Trying to getting a thing. So we end up getting a thing, screws are right there, they see the commotion.
Yeah.
Bang. Come in, grab me, take me to the seg. Yeah. What's going on? We know like this and that. And all this time on the phone.
So they got a whiff of the intel of the situation.
Yep. So on the phone, I've been like talking and saying, oh, babe, can you, like, then I was seeing just a young hood rat. And I was like, and ringing up my sisters and family.
So you're talking red hot on the phone. Yeah. I know what you're talking red hot, trying to get them saying these cunts are going to do this. Can you get this?
Yeah, can I get money?
Can you get money? Otherwise this.
Upers and this and shit.
Intel officers would have heard that. Yeah,
everything's recorded.
Rookie mistake by you, but you were worried and desperate. Yeah,
I was desperate and worried, and usually I don't do that shit.
Yeah.
And I've just, anyway. And I was fiending and just crackhead and fucking this and that. I just got in all my things. Then I talk on the phone. They come, leave me in Segro to that thing. Wait, mate, we know that you're in trouble. Just tell us what's going on. And I'm like, rule number one, you don't talk out of school.
Mm.
You don't fucking say shit, even if you're in that situation. Well, we're going to have to take you out of this situation if you don't tell us what's going on. Them thinking that I don't want to go to the Boneyard of Protection and going to say something, and then they could just move me jails.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't say nothing. So in their situation, we have the duty of care you.
Yeah.
If you're not going to tell us nothing, we're going to have to put you in the Boneyard.
Yeah.
So they put me in the Boneyard.
This is interesting now, because you grew up like me, all right? Back then, I was exactly like you. Boneyarders, putrid as cunts. If you're a Boneyarder, it's... you're stained forever.
Yeah.
You grew up like me. He's a boneyarder. Like that's, boneyarder was like one of the worst things to us, I'm sure to you. Yeah. That's how we looked at it.
Yeah.
It's like, there's a hierarchy. There's child molesters, there's rapists, and there's like boneyarders are only just a bit better than them, you know, like it's a bad thing. So I can imagine like your thoughts in that time, like going through your whole life, not feeling like that. And all of a sudden, like, in that first moment, bro, like when they're threatening you with that and that happens to you, I'm really interested to know, like, what did you think? Did your self-worth just go? Did you?
I wasn't thinking at the moment. All I thought at that time when they're saying, tell us,
yeah,
no telling.
Yeah. So you're just thinking of that, yeah?
I'm just thinking, no telling. It didn't hit. And I said, well, do whatever.
Yeah.
It didn't hit till I was in that position. What did I do?
Because I'm interested, what was the debt? How much was it?
Oh, it's only three strips of beer.
And strips were how much then at Windsor? Nothing, 100 bucks?
Nothing, 100 bucks.
So
yeah.
$300.
Yeah, $300. Oh, and plus all these other like food deals, like buy-up deals.
All right, yes. So which would have added up to another 100, 150.
Yeah, 100 bucks.
All right. Like, so essentially 500 bucks?
Yeah.
If somebody outside could have raked up 500 for you, then all this would have been different.
Yeah, well, I was trying and...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I search because I have no money.
And then, so after that, bro, when they come and got you...
Yeah.
Because I could imagine how that would feel, bro. You would be in there just, like, hating life.
Oh, 100%.
Is it safe to say that you felt putrid?
Yeah, I was putrid. Of course you feel putrid. Everything you believe in and everything you've...
You're going to the fucking bone.
Your principles, your morals, your ethics.
Yeah.
Everything that you believe in.
And there you're on your way.
And now you're there.
Yeah, bro. That's all like, oh.
You're there with nothing. You got the boys singing out, ah, you fucking... You know, because...
Yeah.
A wing's right there. Then you got D where I was.
Yeah, yeah.
You
so you're right next to your old wing.
Give up? And then one of the other lads get grabbed for something arm related.
Yeah.
So automatically they're thinking, this cunt's told. This cunt's given up.
So now anyone in the wing that got done for anything, they're just shouting out to you. You must have told them.
Yeah.
Yep.
So automatically
I know that
their thoughts are like,
I've been that person. Yeah. I've been shouting. Some cunt goes to the protection and there's someone thing, I'll shout out, cunt, you gave him up, you motherfucker.
Yeah, but they're just grabbing like the cunts that they know are troublemakers like this and that. And it had an unrelated to do with me.
Yeah, yeah.
And automatically...
But anyway, they're spearing it on you
Automatically, I'm a dog and I'm this and that.
Is there a protection wing at Windsor or did you have to go to another jail?
No, I had to go to E wing, which is Segro.
Segro, yeah. But is there a protection wing at Windsor? Because I didn't think there was.
No, I had to go to another jail.
What jail did you go to?
I ended up going to... from there, I went to Silverwater.
And so Protection Wing in Silverwater is 17, 18?
Yeah, 17, 18.
It's past the gym, because that's where you see them all walk down.
Yeah, 17, 18.
Right. So that when you walked in those wings, 17, 18, and you walked into a wing, then officially you were a boneyarder. You were in Protection.
I don't know no cunt there. And it's like a whole new world. I don't know no cunt there. And they're all looking at me like, you know, and I'm like, to the bed jumping on the thing, making a spike, like, what the fuck do I have to watch myself? And it's just...
But can I ask you, because I can imagine walking, just by seeing them through the fence, are they noticeably, when you walk in there, I'm not trying to be funny, but are they noticeably more putrid when you walk in there? Like, say when you walk in a Silverwater.
Yeah, of course.
But that's what I think, because I imagine that, but when you walk in Silverwater, you walk in the wings.
They're not just all old.
But are they just like scummy looking cunts and slivery, weirdos? And but that's how I always imagine it. Like, you know, when you walk in Silverwater, you see the boys. Some junkies, some muscly cunts, some cool cunts, whatever. Because I imagine, bro, if you walk in that boneyard, you just see all like little slimy cunts.
Yeah,
no, little rapists.
You get your old cunts, but they mostly cave on.
Yeah.
But you get your young cunts that are in there that are first timers that.
Yeah, that's the thing too, but I want to make this, because I want to make this clear. This is a point that I want to make, is that people, there is a lot of things, and it leads on to what we'll talk about when I tried to get you out. And I did get you out. I got him out of Protection. I couldn't handle watching, but we'll get to that. It's like, I see a lot of cunts go in there, and the screws, you know, for a lot of people, first time in jail, all right, especially if they're small, the screws actively try and put them in Protection. You know, and if they're not, if those people are from, not from the right, say the culture we're from, where we already know as kids, you don't go there. That's the putrid cunts. A lot of people go to jail not knowing anything, and the screws, I hear the screws do this to people. You know, young 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, they go, mate, it's very dangerous in here. You want to just go to Protection, you'll be thing. And a lot of people say yes. I swear to God, I would estimate that, well, at least 20, 30% of people in Protection are only that they're not supposed to be there. They're there because a screw verbaled them. They're not putrid, they're not dogs, they didn't have sex with children, they didn't give people up, you know what I mean? They're just like, but the thing is, but once you're there, that's it.
You're labeled.
That's it. You know what I mean? Like, it changes your life. If you're into that life, if you're into this life, like where jail is a thing, and respect is a thing. The life that I was in, the life that you were in, I learned the truth about that life. But to people like us, that's one of the worst things that you can have.
It was.
In fact, I think that having the label boneyarder is probably worse than having the label rapist, honestly. Because I know boys getting around that, like our hood, that have raped girls that we grew up with. And it's like a comment every now and then, it's like, oh, you know, he raped her. And he's like, oh, really? He's a putrid cunt. But that's, so what? It just goes. But then it's like, it's a level up. It's like, but he was in the boneyard. He was in the boneyard? He's just don't even breathe the same air as him. You know what I mean? Like, but, so what happened, bro? You walked in your cell? Walked in, opened your door up. You got a cellmate? Little boneyard, a cellmate slithering around? Was he in a pile of goo in the corner?
He was under the bed.
He was under the bed.
He was under the bed.
He was under the bed. Was he under the bed masturbating? Not because I
put him there, but he seen me, then went straight under the bed. Because you got to understand, like, them seeing me is exactly like, he's not meant to be here. Because stand out like dog balls.
Yeah. Like, I want to get into that. So from there, bro, like, I haven't seen Ray for a long time. I'm doing my thing, doing my long lag, and right, so I'm in. And I remember, I think it was like 2014.
And
I heard a couple years before that you went to Protection. All right. So then I went to Junee. And Junee Jail is majority Protection.
That's where they send long serving SMAPs.
Long serving SMAPs. So there is four wings at Junee. All right. So there's B1, B2, B3, B4. B1, the entire facility with four individual wings is strict Protection. B2, the entire thing is Protection except one remand. B3, the entire thing is Protection. only B4. So only B4 is main. So you're outnumbered 3-1. Yeah. All right. When you're in June A. June A is like mostly a protection win. In one section. And so you're like, you're just surrounded by, you don't mix with them. You can't mix with them. You're in your own wing. You're behind bars. So you're not with them. But like it is, the ratio is 3-1 at June A. So anyway, I remember being at June A and you were in B3. Yeah. You were in the protection wing. So I could go, if I ever got the basketball court, that would face your wing. Yeah. So I used to come out once a day to the basketball court and sing out to other lads in the Boneyard to get you to come out. And then you'd come out and I'd talk. Because, bro, like, I also done that for Dave. Don't worry about his last name. Dave from Skinny Dave.
Yeah.
Because he's another one of the boys. So the boys we grew up with, I know a good 4 or 5 of the boys that ended up in protection. I used to do the same thing for him because Dave, also like you, he wasn't a putrid cunt.
Yeah.
He wasn't a fucking crown witness, nothing. He just went in there because he was scared, all right? Dave is a skinny Aussie lad. He was in MRRC. The couriers turned on him because another courier was talking shit. He ended up in the Boneyard. He's going to get stabbed. He's scared, done what he done. I hated the fact that he was in there.
Yeah.
Dave is a mad moneymaker. Dave's a cool, he's good. He's a good one of the brothers, you know what I mean? But that's what happens, bro. Like a lot of the boys who are scared, we're getting caught by themselves that can't face these people, they're going to get stabbed. That's how it happens. And justified or not, some may say, well, you shouldn't be scared. You should have stabbed them back. They might be right. But, you know, it's until a lot of people are in that position, you don't know. You don't know that if you're going to stand there, you don't know if you're an Islander and you're going to stand there and there's 5 couriers with blades that are about to kill you. Or if you're an Aussie and there's 5 Tongans that are going to jump on your head or 5 leopards, you don't know. It's easy to say it. It's easy to say, I would do this. It's like, but you probably won't. You know what I mean? And like, I've been put in that position before. I made the right choice, brother. I made the right choice, but we don't all. Do you know what I mean? And that's why I used to sing out to Dave. You know what I mean? And that's why, like, I used to sing out to you. I used to hate the fact that you were in there.
Yeah. Remember, and I used to see you.
And I remember you were embarrassed to see me.
Of course I was embarrassed.
You were embarrassed, bro. You
know what I mean? I was so embarrassed.
Yeah.
I hated seeing you where I was, you know, and it was fucking embarrassed, but...
Then you remember, like, so I talked to you, I remember to adapt,
and I wasn't comfortable, but because heaps of...
Can I ask you something? No, this is real interesting. This is real interesting, bro, because I want to know this. I've always wondered this. In the Boneyard, right? So you're in there with all... anything from a scared person, a person that you know, thing, to the worst.
Yeah.
All right. I want to know. I always wondered: is there a hierarchy within the Boneyard?
Yeah.
All right. Like, are yous all on equal terms, or like, if someone is a dog? So, because in the Boneyard, I know not everyone's a dog, but what if someone is a dog?
Do they get chopped?
Do they still get chopped?
Yeah, they like, still
do
get
other
chopped.
Boneyarders turn on them and say you're rapists, a dog?
They get chopped. They get sent to strict LA.
So they go to strict protection. Yeah, strict protection is the Boneyard of the Boneyard.
So there's SMAP.
Yeah.
And you get to mix with all the other SMAPs. Then there's NA, which is, LA, Limited Association.
Which is strict.
Limited Association. They mix with LA. Then there's NA.
NA's
non-association.
Non-association.
So there's LA, Limited Association, and NA, non-association.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the one where they're in B1, where they... Yeah. Where they have to get escorted everywhere, and when you see them, they look like ET dragged out the swamp.
I used to see them go up to. They're like, bro, I gotta take this jacket off, bro. I used to see. So when we go up to Pills, you know, like when you go up Pills or go up Education, and you see the slimes come up from the strict protection,
and
they'll be like full escorted. Look, it's like not as exaggerated, but it's like you know, when you watch Con Air, and you see Garland Green taking out.
And see how pale like, he is.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we call a strict tan.
Strict tan.
Yeah, because they're not brown; they're white.
They're white.
They're strict tan. They never see the sunlight. They're always indoors.
But in SMAP where you were, dogs get chopped.
Yeah, dogs get chopped and rapists. They get sent.
Is there's I see through the fences a lot of trannies.
Yeah.
So in SMAP, that's where the trannies go.
Yep.
The gays and the trannies.
Yeah, trannies.
So is there like gay circles within the SMAP?
There is little gay.
There is, because nearly every yard at June A, when I'd look through, would have like some lad with tits.
Yeah, they used to go up the library and smoke guns for packets and
no way
and drugs and shit. Yeah, because in the library, main and shit can mix and whatever. Yeah. Like, and you can do little shifties. You
what
know?
Do you mean? So they used to smoke boys from the main.
Yeah, main used to get guns. Yeah, 100%. Like, even in Maine, there'd be some dark horse fucking cunts doing.
You know of course. Yeah, yeah. But I just wanted, I just thought, like, in SMAP, they're more open about it.
Yeah, of course they're more open,
So, in because I know that homosexual stuff in the Maine is almost non-existent.
Yeah.
But I spun out about that because everyone, you know, that yarn.
It is more.
You know that yarn, don't drop the soap. Yeah. There's this, bruh, I swear, 13 years jail, I never seen one person do one sexual thing to one other person.
Yeah.
It just doesn't exist, bruh. But then I was just wondering, like, do people have, like, boyfriends and girlfriends?
In SMAP, yeah, 100%. 110%.
Oh, yeah? Did you? Mums, did you?
No.
All right, so I'm just asking, I'm just asking, brother.
Yeah.
Were you tempted?
No.
Did you ever see any glamours?
No.
All right, it's no, they just asking,
be,
but I'm
yeah,
just
they used to be
like,
men and have bigger white arms than me. Men. They used to have bigger arms than me and fucking three-day growths,
but a ponytail and lipstick.
Like fucking a bit of crushed up fucking match heads as fucking.
Oh, they used to crush up match heads and make it into
lipstick. Yeah.
All right, so, but, look, and remember I was always telling you about, I was just hassling you to come out.
Yeah.
So what I've done is, because I'm here, I'm in the wing in the main there. I'm talking out to you at least 4 days a week.
Yeah, easy.
I felt you didn't deserve to be in there.
Yeah.
All right, like you lived your whole life solid.
Yeah.
You got in a little junkie mind state. You owed one person in one jail $300. Mm. And essentially you spent years in the boneyard over that. Yeah. I wasn't happy with that. I knew you were a brother growing up.
Yeah.
There was nothing bad about you. And I wanted you to be in the main. So what I've done is, I went to the boys in my wing, all right? And I told the boys, and I was one of the main boys. It's not about being a main boy. Yeah. It's not about this and that. It's just I was who I was. And if anyone in the wing had an issue, like they were getting slammed, that's who I was. Yeah. Doesn't mean I stick to myself.
I'm not saying that you were Trump, but you used to.
But fucking, so I pretty much told the boys in my wing, I said, I'm getting my mate Ray, a couple of them already knew who you were from when you were in the main. Yeah. I said, he's not putrid, he's not this, he's not a dog, he's not that. I want to get him out and I want to get him in the wing with me and I'm looking after him. I said to the boys, is there an issue with that? And they all said, nah, Ray's a mad cunt, get him out. They all said that.
Yeah.
They all said, you're a mad cunt, get him out.
Yeah, I love the boys.
Mana, Joel, Ryan, all the boys, they all said, get him out. And I remember when you come out, you signed out and you come out and you come into my wing.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Lack of weight relief.
Like. So that was like the first time you, after what, 2.5 years in the boneyard, you come into my cell with me.
Yeah.
And we'll live in large because I was doing, what was I doing? Running a shop.
You were running a shop. Not only that, you've run everything. Like, not everything, but because your respect and people respected you, shit that used to come in, you used to get a cut too. Used to get a cut.
Yeah.
Used to get a cut and do your thing and not that you weren't getting
living
dosh.
Well. Living
not
well.
That you weren't getting dosh, but all of your legit cash used to go straight to your hip hop collection.
Legit. I had a mad CD collection.
Oh,
hey.
Brother, yeah. It was the first time that I
had the best CD collection in jail.
100%.
Mums, what did I have? Things people never heard of. Army of the Pharaohs, Jedi Mind Tricks, Immortal Technique albums. Yeah. I just the sickest hip hop collection.
And it was the first time
I had a Necro CD.
The
Necro
first time
Death
that
rap.
I heard Vinnie Paz.
Yeah.
And that song Albino Gorilla.
Oh, that's apathy. That's an apathy song.
Albino Gorilla.
Yeah, I had an apathy CD. Self-titled album.
No word. You had this thing where you could like hypnotize people, but you had the
What do you mean?
Like the lady that used to do the activities buy-ups. I got the CD you wanted. Like like all these CDs, like she used to, I don't know, like.
Well, I do stunts, but like,
yeah, the activity stunt, lady loved you and could get these things. Like these CDs, no one's ever heard of. And in a little town like Junee, get them CDs in.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? It was like.
She used to
jump through hoops, brother. You know what I mean?
Like, we used to get them ordered from the United States.
That's what I mean. Like, you know, she used but, to pull a lot of, anyway, yeah.
Anyway, yeah, fucking, I had you in a cell with me.
Yep.
And what was, we were training, remember I was training you?
Yep. Training, jiu-jitsu.
Jiu-jitsu.
Wrestling.
Yeah, jiu-jitsu.
We used to get the striking pads out.
Yeah, striking, jiu-jitsu.
Striking, jiu-jitsu.
Every day, bar.
And kicking.
And anyway, life was all fun. Had you in the main for a while.
Yeah.
Training, doing jiu-jitsu, kicking thing.
Yeah.
Break mad fades, mad music, this and that. And I was happy, bro. I was happy that you were in the main back with the boys.
Happy too.
The boys respected you.
Yeah.
You told your part. I remember the boys asked you one time when you come out. They said, what happened? You told them what happened. The boys that were there agreed with me that you shouldn't have been in there.
Yeah.
Everyone was very happy. You had no issues.
Yeah.
Until one day, he turns around and everything that I taught him for 2 months before, jiu-jitsu, kickboxing, everything, he turns around and uses it on all the screws and gets in to take siege of the wing. What happened there, brother? Tell him what happened there. Well, I'm out there training. No, I'm playing chess. I'm playing chess with Joel. Next minute, screws getting bashed. Another screws get an orange popped at his head. This bloke's here pumping all the screws. They bring down like eight. It was like a, honestly, it went for like 4 minutes.
Yeah.
But tell me what happened.
What happened was I got, without you knowing, which I regret, I should have told you, but I wanted it to be a surprise.
Yeah.
I was trying to get Bupe sent in the mail. And
here he goes again, sending Bupe in the mail. Do you remember what happened last time?
Yeah.
Anyway, he's back to his old tricks.
And really, I got a cent before I come over to there, but I was on the phone and I got another one sent.
Yep,
so that one must have got intercepted, but I got another one sent. And
so you got Bupe sent in the mail, what you're saying, yeah?
And next minute, they call me up to door nine.
Yep. Door nine is the inter office's door.
This and that, and we know you're fucking doing this, do a U-run, this and that. So they send me back to the wing, escorted with fucking thing, but I know that they're going to come rent the cell.
Yep.
I know that's the first, just from stock standard protocol procedures that they're going to come rent the cell.
Yep.
And I knew that you were but you had shit in there that could cop.
Say it, I don't care. It's old.
You had a mobile phone.
Yeah.
You had SIM cards. You had USB sticks with porn on it and packets.
Relax, brother.
Drugs,
but yes.
Fucking.
I have a family.
Contraband.
I have a family, brother, but yeah.
Contraband that I knew that could get you extra time. Stock standard 5 years, 2 years for charging, whatever. So I know that if they get to the cell, that they're going to fucking find it, like this and that.
Yeah,
I believe that you had the phone in the fucking...
Yeah, I get you.
The what? TV charging.
Did I?
Yeah, in the back because you just used to leave it at the back. So I know they go in there like the fucking thing.
I'm not agreeing or disagreeing. I'm listening.
The only reason I fucking thing is to get them out of here and fucking thing. So the only thing I knew how to do was to start talking shit and bridging up. And then...
So pretty much what he's saying is he knew that he was going to get our cell raided by something he'd done on the sly. I had stuff in there that would get me more jail. So before you got our cell raided, you took it upon yourself to bash all the screws as a distraction.
Yeah.
How did this happen? Tell me the breakdown.
Mr. Foster the dog, he was intel with a fucking beard and tall cunt. He used to think it was a mad cunt, this and that. And I really felt, when I was training with him and the Mushi showed me, I felt like Superman. I felt like I could take on the fucking world.
I had you doing mad moves,
mad hectic moves.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Mr. Foster's talking shit and we'll see how smart you are when we take your cell ramp and fucking this and that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I just turned around and let's have it. Do it now then, dickhead. I done a little fucking jab and a little like hit. Then, I like fake with the mad, that 1-2 mad fucking kick you showed me how to do. Bang, kicked into the chest.
Oh, the fake, the question mark kick.
Yeah,
the fake question, and then bring it over.
And over. So I've done the question mark
kick. And I remember your door boot, what I seen is you hit a screw twice, sent him, another screw got kicked, then you found an orange somewhere, pegged it in another screw's back.
Yeah, because they were running to hit the fucking duress.
And some screw bridged up to you like it was the fighter of the screws.
Yeah, yeah.
And I remember Mr. Foster?
Yeah.
And I remember you just done a straight door boot.
Yeah.
And you just went like sliding.
Yeah. Yeah, I've done what you showed me.
Yeah.
The one I was going to do that mad knee that you showed me.
Yeah,
we go 1-2 knee.
Yeah.
And you use the whole force of your body, but he was too thin, so I just done an off right kick to his chest.
Yeah.
He fell down. That's when one of the boys grabbed me. Don't worry, they're not worth it. And fucking.
I'll tell you what happened there. So while you were fighting, you quickly talked over that. Went for a good 3-4 minutes. You were having standoffs.
Yeah.
And the screws were coming to me because they knew I changed it a fight.
Yeah.
All right, and they were coming to me because they weren't they found out that they can't stop you. You were out muscling them, out pumping them. All right, so they were all standing back. The screws, I remember specifically one of the female screws that always come to me for everything. She come up and she was saying, "Anthony, please stop him. Please stop him." In my head, all right, I wanted to stop you.
Yeah.
All right, I'll tell you why. Because you were in for a long time. You were supposed to get parole soon.
Yeah, I was. All right?
I wanted to stop you, not for the screw's sake. I was laughing seeing the screws get pumped. It was one of the best things I've seen in 8 months.
Yeah.
All right? I was laughing, but I knew that like one wrong punch, if you hurt one of these screws too bad, you're doing another thing. Yeah. So I was stuck in the world of saving you, but I also know that if I go and pull you off the screws, if you're bashing screws and I go and essentially make an arrest or like I'm a security guard, in my culture, that's putrid.
Yeah.
You do not stop screws, coppers getting bashed. Otherwise, it's close to me being a dog. So it's like I could go up and I could stop you and then I could turn around to the boys and say, no, I was just looking after him. Very easily, some of those boys could have turned around to me and they're like, lad, you're a fucking copper.
Yeah.
Like that's in jail. Yeah. If you're that's stopping, if you're, I'm stopping crime happening. Like, wait a minute. In jail, the way we're raised, especially like in Maxo ALJs in the yard, you do not stop crimes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that's, and that's how it always been. So I wanted to stop you, but I couldn't because I know like that word could easily get around. What about Spanian? The cunt's fried. Ray was pumping the screws. Spanian went up like a full security guard and stopped it. That's putrid for me.
Yeah.
So I let one of the other boys stop you.
Yeah.
And Ryan, Joel end up coming and stopping you. I was secretly happy you stopped him.
Yeah.
And I was secretly happy it wasn't me.
Yeah.
But then so, Joel turned around to me and he's like, boys, don't think I'm a screw, but I just didn't want him to get in trouble. And I said straight away, I agree with you.
Yeah, and like, I thank you for that. I ended up getting charged. I ended up getting tipped. I get an A2 class out of that.
Yeah.
Ended up getting tipped.
So you got a from June maximum security. Yep. You got tipped to Goulburn.
To Goulburn.
Yeah.
I lost box visits, all that shit, and the stock standard thing. And I got outside charged.
So you got outside charged. So you got further court case because of it, further time because
and
of it.
And like you said, I was up for parole.
Yeah. So obviously I lost you got my parole back. And how much extra did you end up getting?
18 months.
Not extra 18 months.
No, because of the year parole.
Yeah. And then
and
6 months
on top for the three times assault.
Yeah.
I got done for three times assault. Officer, not police.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah. I'll get you. Yeah, of course. Yep. Officer. And so next thing, you're now in Goulburn. So you're in there in the main now, but you're in the main with lads that would have known that you were in the Boneyard straight off you got there.
Yeah.
The how were you? So you went into the courtyard, obviously. Yeah. How were you accepted? Like, how did that, was it easy?
It wasn't easy for me. I was tossing up wherever I go back before I even hit the yard.
Yeah.
But the inner me was like, no. Stick with it. I'm going to not just do it for Sven, do it for me.
Yeah.
I don't deserve to be in there.
Yeah.
Effort, like
so
I'm
you
here.
Got in there. How long were you in the main there?
I was in the main for about a year and probably about eight.
So you lasted about a bit under a year?
Yeah, under
and
a year.
And what happened? Like?
The boys just gave me an ultimatum because they said...
They started turning on you.
Yeah, they started
turning. Wrong people showed up.
Yeah, wrong people showed up.
People getting spiteful.
Yeah, spiteful because...
I know it is. He's in the Boneyard, bro. You shouldn't even be here after a while. They accept you for a few months, and a few months later, if something simple... I've seen it heaps, bro. Like someone be in that position and someone will have like Yandi and they want a cone, they can't get a cone.
Yeah.
Fuck you, bro. You're from the Boneyard anyway. This comes from the Boneyard.
In Goulburn, it's all segregated. So you got Brothers Yard, Asians, Aussies, Asians, this and that. And in the Boneyard, on the SMAP side, it's the same. You got Brothers Yard, a green yard, which is just Gronks, and then you got the Blue Yard, which is kind of like the Trump Yard,
the toughest of the Boneyard,
but it's all Aussies.
But all Aussies,
all Aussies. So you got
haven't they got a gang in there?
Yeah, W2K, willing to kill them.
It's like an Aussie Boneyard gang.
Yeah, Aussie Boneyard or skinheads.
All
skinheads. Not one black person in there.
So you're in the yard now, all white supremacists.
I choose to go to the Blue Yard.
Yeah. All right.
I choose to go to the Blue Yard because...
And most of them Aussie lads in there are probably in there by getting jumped by couriers.
By couriers.
So here you are walking in there.
I go there because even in that 2 years that I was in the Boneyard, I still had to build myself up.
Yeah.
Like not a rep. You wouldn't say a rep, but yourself and this and that. So in the Boneyard, you get to, like you said, the hierarchy.
Yeah.
I got to know a few of the people that were in W2K.
Yeah.
So I go into the yard there and most of the business is there.
Yeah.
So me, I've got no cunt visiting.
Yeah.
I've got no cunt, so...
So you're in there doing business.
In order, I have to go there to hustle.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I go there to hustle.
What's that like? What's that yard like compared to the other yards?
Oh, it's hectic.
Oh, you know what? I'm going to tell you the honest truth. I actually heard, this is going to sound surprising to a lot of people. A lot of people have a misconception about Goulburn. I actually heard that the Boneyard in there is one of the most dangerous places. Like people get attacked silly down in there.
It is. And in all my time there, there was only, all the time there, I've done a few years there.
Yeah.
Like two and a half.
Yep.
And in all my time, there was only one fatality.
One murder.
Yeah, but he survived. He was pronounced dead.
Oh, he was pronounced dead. So one near death.
Yeah, one near death.
Bad stabbing.
Airlifted. Where they had to get the airlift.
And where was that? In the Boneyard.
In the Boneyard, in my yard.
Oh, and that was the only one in the whole Goulburn.
Yeah,
the only airlifting while you were there in 2.5 years actually come out the Boneyard.
Yeah, out of the Boneyard, yeah.
And what, the skinhead Trump's got someone?
Yeah, he was another black lad. He thought that he could do the same as me.
Oh, so the skinhead Trump's in there. The skinheads airlifted another Koori lad out of the Boneyard.
He weren't Koori.
Oh, black bar.
Yeah, he was black.
Like African or Maori. Islander. Oh, Maori. Islander. All right, yeah. So they turned on him.
Yeah.
He tried to do your stunts.
Yeah, he tried to come there and stun on.
Yeah.
Thought he could do the hustle, this and that. Yeah. He bumped heads with some cunt that you don't want to bump heads with.
Yeah.
He had 3 times to get out that yard that day.
Yeah.
Even I told him, he thought that me being black, I was going to back him, but
yeah.
I can't.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
against 50 cunts.
Yeah, 50 skinheads, yeah.
And one of them said, yeah, it's going to be a fair go, one-on-one. Yeah. Well, all this time they're saying it's a fair go, they've got the kettle on.
Yeah.
Boiling. Yeah. The kettle's boiling. I don't care if you're the biggest, toughest cunt.
Yeah.
The kettle's boiling, we jam in it. Like little satchels of jam.
Yeah.
He's got his shirt off, ready, thinking he's going to have a fight, one-on-one. They're boiling the jug. Bang, as soon as that hot water hit his face and the clunks of jam stuck onto him, he turned white. Like he's ripping off the clunks of jam that are sticking to his skin.
And you seen this?
I've seen it. I've witnessed it.
You were there, yeah.
I'm watching it. Like.
And so what? So all these skinheads, they told this Maori lad, get it, like, fuck off. And he thought, nah, I'm going to fight it. And no, they just full hot jammed
him. No, they said that it's going to be a one-on-one.
Oh, so they sent him
so up. They wanted, but now one of the boys, Louis, said, fuck this. I want to set an example.
Yeah.
I want this cunt fucking, you know.
Yeah.
Got.
Yeah.
So, and when he said God, so they've hit him in the face with the hot water, all these clunks of gems, he's ripping it off, skin's just peeling him, as this, 3 of them's just stabbing him.
Oh,
with
yeah.
old rusty, they break off the fence, like the spikes on the fence that are like that thick, and made him shit, and they're stabbing the fuck out of him. He got stabbed like easy 37 times.
Oh yeah.
They stabbed, the only thing that saved him was a screw was coming back from Edgeo, up the back alleyway.
Yeah.
With the brothers, with Sione and all the other brothers, like coming back.
Yeah.
And they witnessed the fucking thing. That's when they even shot, like the guards on the tower shot.
No way.
Into the yard. And so the only thing that got him out the yard was adrenaline.
Oh, so while he ran to the fence,
bleeding,
he would have collapsed at the fence.
Yeah, he collapsed, the screws had let in shots. They didn't give a fuck, they want to get rid of the murder weapons, fucking...
Spin out forts, eh? So anyway then, how long ago did you get out?
I got out about 3 years ago, 4 years.
3 years ago. You haven't been back since?
No.
So you're working and stuff now, eh? You got a family, this and that?
Got a family, got a job.
Fuck jail, eh, bro?
Fuck jail.
I'm the same as you, bro. So I got out 4 years ago, 2017. And, bro, I look at jail, bro. It's just like the biggest, gronkiest shit that I've ever done in my life, bro. And I've done, you know, and I fought. I tried my best in jail, bro. Stuck staunch. It's not a mark on my name, bro. And I just, even still, bro, and I was like always about, like, repping and just, you know, following the rules, the criminal code. And it's just, bro, and I look back and it's just what a rubbish life that was, bro. Just a rubbish life, just surrounded by dirty, stinking men in a shower.
Yeah.
And they all bitch behind each other's back. That's and right. just rubbish, bro.
It's just school antics. It's just fucking but putrid on roids, and it's just putrid, bro. I'd rather be out here battling than in jail battling.
Yeah.
With nothing.
But let me ask you something, like, so now, bro, you're out. You got a family. you got a missus, you got a kid, some boys out here, you live your life out here, you work, your life's better than it's ever been. How does, do you think that you're going to protection, all right, back in, back whenever that, does that mean anything to your family? Does that mean anything to your missus or your kid?
Nothing.
Exactly, bro. Because you know what, like, that's, I done a hood logic once, bro, and a hood logic on labeling. And you know what I noticed, bro, about these, like, labels, you know what I mean? Of these criminal labels that we used to get by, like, Boneyard, and he's a pugil hunter, or he's a dog, this and that. And, you know, and because everyone chucks it around on the internet. If you, because I'm a rapper, bro. So, and you should see every comment section is like, that's the diss. You got all these 15-year-old kids that have just started spray painting last year, and all of a sudden they call everyone boneyarders. Yeah, no, I just repeat, onkies from, not from the life. And it's just, they're so caught up with these labels. And I say to them, I say, brother, listen, I live that life, my whole life. I've done everything to, for, I'm this, I'm that, I'm that, I'm not this, I'm not that, bro. And at the end of it, I found out, bro, this is what I found out. The people that matter in your life, your family, your close friends that would actually visit you, or you know, piss on you if you were on fire, your kids, your partner, they don't give a fuck if you've been to the boneyard. It's meaningless to them. If I tell my missus, if I tell my son, if I tell my mum, I was in the boneyard in 2006, I got this, I got jumped and I was in the boneyard, they're gonna be like, I don't care, why are you telling me that rubbish? That's Gronk shit, who cares about that? I don't care what yard you're in. And you know what I noticed? It's all the people who are not important to you. They're the ones that care. All the random bums in the shower, all the cunts from the other side of the country, all the other scums that you run into in the street that wouldn't piss on you if you're on fire, they're the ones that wanna jump on like, he's a boneyarder. You've lost all respect to me. What respect? You know what I mean? So like this, I'm just thinking like the cunts that don't respect you for being in the boneyard, who are they to you?
Nothing.
They're nobody to you. You know what I mean? And that's what, like, I just want everyone to know, but the people who most who are most important to you in your life couldn't give two fucks if you were a dog or if you were a this or a that. They don't care. You know what I mean? And but that's like, you come out here and it's, here we are essentially the same. You went to protection. I didn't go to protection. You didn't stick staunch, I stuck staunch. I got myself a name in jail, you lost your name in jail. Sitting here right now, what difference does it make?
Nothing.
Nothing to no one. The only difference is I'll have some kids on the internet that think I'm cooler than you because I was a tough guy in jail and you were a boneyarder. You get my point?
Yeah.
That's why, bro. That's why I said to you, that's why I wanted you, not only because of that, because of your whole life. Your life is crazy. You've been in that life since day dot. You've been on these streets before, like, you know what I mean? You've seen more than anyone's seen. But I wanted to, like, make that point. Everyone's big on saying this and saying that, labeling everyone, and it don't make a difference to anyone except for a bunch of gronks that never mean nothing to you anyway. Anyway, brother, that was a good episode. I'm glad you come on here, shared your life, bar, everything you've been through. That was grouse, bar. And you come out the other end and look at you now, bar, working, looking after your kid. And I see how you are with your kid, brother. You're one of the best dads.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, bro. Your kid's your life.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing that matters, true, bro?
I just want to make sure he don't have that.
Yeah. That's right, brother. That's it. That's it.